Get her and stand there so I have a little room between you. Not yet. Stay here. I'll tell you when to go. Relax. Who giveth this woman to be married to this man? Now you go get her. Go ahead. He's anxious to get this over with. You may be seated. Stand back for me a little bit. Good. On behalf of the McGill and Crockett families, I welcome all of you to this service today. If the Apostle Paul was here, he could start a church with just your two families. But I have a confession to make. I have done dozens of weddings. I've done them in barns. I've done them in college campuses. I've done them on lakeside. I've done them in churches. I had to do one in a prison once, and I did one in a garage. Fortunately, it was a two-car garage because a storm came up and blew all the tent away. So we crowded into a garage. But I tell you the truth, I have never, ever been surrounded by so many beautiful, beautiful people. Give them a hand. Turn around. You don't take their hands until I tell you. Okay. Sorry. No, thank you. Give him another hand. In the traditional language of the church, we use the word to describe you as the dearly beloved. Now, those words are old and worn with use because they say what needs to be said. All of you are here because you hold a special place of affection in the hearts of Mitchell and Lauren, and that's why you're here. You're the ones they first shared the secret of their love with you. And that's when the celebration started. And then they shared with you, they're actually going to get married. And you got an invitation. The celebration continues. Let me remind you, this celebration will not begin and end today. After the last dance, we're going to dance? Good, we're going to dance. And after the last glass of champagne, are we having champagne? Okay, after the last glass of champagne, after the last dance, this celebration must and will continue. Let me tell you how it should continue. Completely believe in their love for each other. Support their love for each other. And if problems should arise, don't give them advice. Just listen to what they have to say. Don't share with them your failures or your disappointments in relationships. Share with them your victories when love was renewed and rekindled. Share with them those moments when you sought forgiveness and got it, and when you gave forgiveness and it was received. If you do all of that, you will continue to support and continue the celebration. If that doesn't work, remind them of their vows. If that doesn't work, tell them to call the minister to counsel them and marry them. My number is 315-868-6023. Write it down. Come forward. We have spent several hours together. You're learning about each other, and I learned a lot about you. Oh my goodness. In every wedding I do, we have a Myers-Briggs inventory, personality inventory. Guess what? They're very different. Did you know that? You knew that, didn't you? And we do a Ben Franklin kind of a ledger. On the one side, it says, what do I want from this relationship? On the other side, what am I willing to give to this relationship? And you don't share it with each other till you show up in my office and open it up. Typical, you get it detailed. You wrote a few dots right away. For all I know, he wrote it on a napkin on the way here. I don't know. Am I right? Yeah, you can say it. It's all right. Lauren is super organized. How many knew that? Woo. He's not. He doesn't have an organized bone in his body. Did we not know that? However, your differences can be your gift to each other. You will need her organization. You will need from time to time his spontaneity. Maybe crazy, but accept it. That's your gift to one another. You both process through your feelings and your thinking, and that is also very important. Let me share something that we learned. She's an introvert, you're an extrovert. Women in general, and that includes all of you women out there, and you here, and you. You need to share your problems and talk about them, right? And to have a significant other or a husband who will listen without comment. Well, that's not easy, is it? Men want to solve your problem. You don't go to tell your problems to a man to have him solve them, because you need to talk about them. You probably can solve them yourself. So gentlemen out there, if you want to endear yourselves to a loved one, listen without comment. Don't ever roll your eyes. Oh my goodness, don't do that. That is important. Listening, according to Scott Peck, is the greatest act of love you can give each other. Just listen to one another. I think it's important that you respect each other's individuality. You don't have to do everything together. You can do things separate from each other. Some people say, I can't live without him. Yeah, you can. Can you live with him? I can't live without her. Yeah, you can. Can you live with her? That is the test. And I encourage you, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Because the next day you wake up and, okay, it's all right, but it will come up again. So talk about the things that bother you to each other and listen. Oh, one other thing, gentlemen, I should tell you. You not only endear yourself to a woman if you listen. Keep in mind, for a woman, a hug is just a hug. It's not an invitation for anything else. Am I right? It's not a green light for anything else. It's a hug. Ugh. Find a place that you can worship together. That's so important. lock hands together, because you're going to soon do your vows. Find a place where you can worship. Worship is vital to a strong relationship, because you go to church to be reminded, because worship is thanksgiving for the gift of your life. And we need to be reminded that in this day and age, time and time again, what a gift life is that we have together. The last part is maybe the hard part. Eric Fromm, in his great book, I recommend you find it, The Art of Loving. You never heard of it? Loving is an art. You got to work at it. You want to learn how to swim? What do? You work at swimming. You want to learn to ride a bike? You work at riding a bike. Now, you don't have to wake up every morning, Mitchell, and say, oh, God, I got to start working on loving Lauren. You don't have to do that. And you don't have to wake up every morning and think, oh, God, I got to work on loving this lunkhead. You don't do that. It's okay. But let me tell you what the Apostle Paul said. He wrote this letter to a very troubled church. No one was getting along. And he said, basically, I don't care how religious you are, your faith, your hope, if you don't have love, you're phony. And here's what he said. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not arrogant, and certainly not rude. It does not rejoice in wrong, but rejoices in the right. It's patient. It's loving. And he ends this letter by saying, now there is faith, and there is hope, and there is love. I don't care what your faith is in your relationship. If it's not viewed through love, it will fail. I don't care what your hopes for the future are. If they're not viewed with love, they too will fail. As we'll soon hear in the song, love is the perfect gift. Each other. Now that Mitchell and Lauren had made it their intention to bind themselves together in marriage. I ask you to repeat after me. First, Mitchell. I, Mitchell, do take you, Lauren, to be my wife. I promise before God and these witnesses to be your loving and faithful husband. In times of plenty and in times of want. In times of joy and in times of sorrow. In times of sickness and in times of health. I promise to share my thoughts and my feelings with you openly and honestly. And I also promise to respect your individuality. That's a hard one, isn't it? Try it again. I also respect your individuality and to love you always. Good. This individuality is not easy. Can't even pronounce it, right? Okay, you repeat after me. I, Lauren, do take you, Mitchell, to be my husband. I promise before God and these witnesses to be your loving and faithful wife. In times of plenty and in times of want. In times of joy and in times of sorrow. In times of sickness and in times of health. I promise to share my thoughts and my feelings. You better listen. With you openly and honestly. I also promise to respect your individuality. And I promise to love you. That's called a kingdom prayer. Your father will now sing. Turn around, please.
We join.
Okay, Lauren, what did you bring as a token of your love for Mitchell?
A ring.
This ring was first given by your great-grandfather in 1913. You have that ring? Please place this on his finger and repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my vow.
As a symbol of my vow.
And all that I am.
And all that I am.
And all that I have.
And all that I have.
I give to you in God's name.
I give to you in God's name.
Amen.
Amen.
Good. What token do you have?
A ring.
You have a ring. No kidding. Give me the ring. Wow. That's a nice ring. Put that on her finger, please. Lauren, I give you this ring. As a symbol of my vow.
As a symbol of my vow.
And with all that I am,
with all that I am,
all that I have,
all that I have,
I honor you in the name of God. Amen.
In the name of God. Amen.
Good. Turn around, face me. Let us pray. Eternal God, creator and preserver of all life, author of salvation and giver of all grace, look with your favor upon this world you have made and redeemed, and especially on Lauren and Mitchell. Give them wisdom and devotion in the common life, that each may be to the other a strength in need, a counselor in perplexity, a comfort in sorrow, and a companion in joy. Grant that their wills may be so knitted together in your will, that their spirits in your spirit, that they may grow in love and peace with you and each other all the days of their life. Give them the grace when they hurt each other to recognize and confess their sin and their fault, and to seek each other's forgiveness and yours. Make this life together a sign of Christ's love to this sinful and broken world, that unity can overcome estrangement. Forgiveness can heal guilt, and joy can conquer despair. Give them such fulfillment of their mutual vows that they may be each to the other a concern for others. Give to them, if it is your will, the gift of children and the wisdom to bring them up to know you, to love you, and to serve you. Grant that all who have witnessed these vows today may find their lives strengthened, and after all who are married may depart with their own promises renewed. Enrich with your grace all husbands and wives, parents and children, that loving and supporting each other, they may serve those in need and be a sign of your kingdom. Grant that the bonds by which your children are united to one another may be so transformed by your spirit that your peace, your justice may fill the earth through Jesus Christ our Lord. This is our promise.
Thank you.
That makes me want to cry. Okay, finally, you can come forward. You've waited long enough. Since you have confirmed your promises by the joining of hands and the giving and receiving of ring, therefore I now proclaim that you are now husband and wife. Give her a kiss. I'm old. I can do better than that. Kiss her again. And now may the grace of Christ attend you, the love of God surround you, and the Spirit keep you, that you may live in faith, abound in hope, and grow in love, both now and forevermore. Amen. You may go. Wait. Okay, go. Go.